I want to introduce our speaker this morning. Hagay Amit is a CNRS researcher at Nantes in France, at the Lab of Planetology and Geodynamics. A little bit on his background: he got his BS in physics and atmospheric science at Hebrew University in Jerusalem, and then did a master's in hydrology, which I think we're going to hear about today. and then got his PhD in geophysics at Johns Hopkins University, and then did a postdoc, a Marie Curie 3-year postdoc at IPGP in Paris before starting his job in Nantes. And today he's talking to us about the South Atlantic magnetic anomaly from core to atmosphere. Okay.
Thanks a lot, Peter. Thanks for the invitation. It's a pleasure to be here. I'll be talking about something called the South Atlantic Magnetic Anomaly, which is a region at Earth's surface where the magnetic field is anomalously weak. Here it's in the dark colors. And this region originates from a region at the core mantle boundary where the radial magnetic field is reversed with respect to the sign of the axial dipole field. And if this region is persistent and it's around there for a long time, then it's probably due to some mantle heterogeneity in this region as well. And it also has consequences for the ionospheric field and for the locations of these spectacular auroral zones at Earth's surface today at high latitudes. So this work has been done in collaboration with numerous South American colleagues, which are obviously interested in this phenomena because it's centered today right in South America, from Brazil and from Argentina. But most of the work that I'll present was done by my ex-PhD student, Philippa Terranova, which is now in Sao Paulo doing a postdoc, and by Ana Elias from Argentina concerning the ionospheric field. So the starting point is the internal structure of the Earth that is known to us from seismology. We know that the mantle is mostly silicate and solid, so it's insulating. At a depth of 2,900 kilometers lies the core mantle boundary. Below that, the material is liquid and metallic, so this is the region where the dynamo is being generated by electrical currents. And the inner core is also metallic but solid, and it is the freezing of light elements while in the inner core boundary that is an important source of energy for the dynamo. The magnetic field is measured today by satellites. This is the Swarm constellation of three satellites, and by magnetic observatories. For example, this one at the mouth of the Amazon River that has been recently installed. And like in any other field of geophysics, data deteriorates as we go backwards in time, but the deterioration is not linear. There are certain key dates when things improved considerably. Since 2000, we have satellites that provide global coverage and very high quality of data. So that's an important landmark in observed geomagnetism. Since 1840, Gauss introduced intensity measurements. So we have a full vector of three components of magnetic field that is monitored in surface observatories. So that's a continuous and direct observation, but it's still not global because there are many holes in the map of the Earth where we don't have surface observatories in oceans, in high latitudes, in the southern hemisphere. Prior to 1840, there are some data from ship logs, and Peter mentioned to me that the Carnegie Institute had a ship that was sailing at the beginning of the 20th century and provided data of this kind. Well, the Carnegie ship was not as crucial as the ships that cover this period, when there was very few surface observatories on the Earth. So this data is also direct, but it's not continuous. So in terms of separating the signal to internal and external field, it's a bit less useful. And prior to that, in the last 3,000 years, there are archaeological material. So this is not direct information. It's material that was magnetized while it was formed. And therefore, the uncertainty is much larger, and there's also uncertainty on the dating. This is a particular good example of data. It's an old church from South Brazil, And there, the date at which they constructed the church is actually written on the building. So in this case, they know for sure the date, but that's not always the case. And when you model the field from these observatories, that's what you typically get. So this is the field downward continued to the core mantle boundary from wherever it is measured, at the surface or at satellite altitude. This downward continuation is a simple solution to the Laplace's equation. So this is quite a robust mathematical procedure. This is the radial field at the CMB, and that's the secular variation. It's its rate of change with time. And what we see is that most of the field is blue, is negative in the northern hemisphere, and most of it is red, positive in the southern hemisphere. It means that field lines are coming out of the core in the southern hemisphere and re-enter the core in the northern hemisphere. But there are some deviations from this axial dipolarity, especially below the South Atlantic, where are these things that we call the reverse flux patches. And these are one of the focuses of the talk today. And obviously, when we go backwards in time, the data uncertainties force us to regularize much stronger the models and to dump small scales and high frequencies. So much of this detailed structure disappears in, for example, archaeomagnetic field models. So as I mentioned before, the South Atlantic anomaly is a region where today the surface, at the surface of the Earth, where the field intensity is weakest. If we look at the evolution of this minimum from the time that Gauss started measuring intensity until today, it is in generally going westward from mid-Atlantic to below inland Brazil, a little bit southward, and in the last 20 years, it's almost going purely westward. And in conjunction to that, there is also a decrease in the intensity, which is represented here by the colors. So we would like to understand why is it located here? Why is it moving in the path that it's moving, and why is it decreasing in its intensity? At the same time, the axial dipole, which is a global property of the field, is decreasing very fast. Since it started being measured in 1840 until today, it's going down quite rapidly. And the dipole decrease has been related to the emergence and the intensification of reverse flux patches on the core mantle boundary. So if reverse flux patches are both related to dipole decrease and to the South Atlantic anomaly, it means that the South Atlantic anomaly is related to dipole decrease in some non-trivial way. And this motivates us to examine the relation between the South Atlantic anomaly and reversals of the magnetic field, which are extreme events of long dipole decrease. At the right, we show the rate of change of the dipole decrease, so just the temporal derivative of that, and we see that it goes up and down, so it's not perfectly linear, and there is some suggestion of flattening today, so deacceleration of the dipole decrease. So the question, one of the questions I would like to address is this anomaly always going to be in the South Atlantic, or is it just a transient, chaotic, time-dependent feature of the geodynamo? And I will show two conflicting approaches in the literature, in the recent literature. One is coming from data assimilation. In this process, they use observations to initialize a dynamical self-consistent calculation and let the system go. The system at the beginning evolves in the same way as purely mathematical linear extrapolation that doesn't care about the physics. But after a certain time, the two procedures depart and the linear extrapolation is no longer valid. And when these calculations are run, they reach a prediction that the South Atlantic anomaly will actually no longer be South Atlantic. In 2115, it will drift all the way to mid-Pacific. So based on this calculation, it's not necessarily a persistent feature of the dynamo. In contrast, there are many studies of archaeomagnetic field models that find persistent emergence of reverse flux patches in the South Atlantic region. And in particular, this study by Tarduno et al. 2015 finds very old events of the decrease, local decrease of intensity below the South Atlantic, which they argued is related to the emergence of a reverse flux below Africa that is later drifting towards South America and the periodicity of this kind of process. So this is an open question. In geodynamo studies, it's kind of rare to find problems that touch humanity in some way, and this is one of them, because the geomagnetic field is shielding the Earth from the penetration of energetic particles that are dangerous for biology. And in an area where the field is especially weak, there is more penetration than in other areas. So this is causing degradation of electronics on satellites that are going through the South Atlantic anomaly region. And even there's a study that claims that there's more health problems for pilots that go through this region. What they found is that pilots that go about twice a week in the trajectory of Paris to Buenos Aires have more chances to get special types of cancer than, for example, pilots that go twice a week Paris to San Francisco. So understanding and forecasting the South Atlantic anomaly and its evolution has some importance for humanity, especially for communication satellites and the planning of the orbits. So the questions I will address here is, what's the relation between the structures on the core mantle boundary and the intensity minima at the Earth's surface? And I will apply some simple mechanisms, simple scenarios of secular variation to understand the motion of the anomaly. And in particular, if there are reverse flux patches extending all the way from Africa to South America, why is it that the anomaly is not at the center of this structure, but at one of its corners below South America? Then I will look at the question of the persistence of the anomaly. And to do that, I will look at numerical dynamos with core mantle boundary heat flux patterns that are inferred from seismology of the lowermost mantle to see whether the anomaly can be indeed locked to its current place. And in particular, to establish the relation between this thermal boundary condition on the dynamo, the core flow it generates, the radial field on the CMB, and the surface intensity minima. And I will finish a little bit with the effect of the South Atlantic anomalies on the ionospheric field, in particular during polarity reversals. So I will outline the methods that will be used for all these studies. These studies are divided into three papers, that one of them was published last year, and the other two were accepted in the last 2 weeks, actually. And I'll finish with some future perspectives. So the first thing was to establish topological algorithms to identify and track reverse and normal flux patches. And in order to do that, we had to define what is reverse and normal. The conventional definition is that it is based on the geographic equator, but that's not a very satisfactory one, because in some snapshots, there is a structure that is sitting on the geographic equator, and such a definition would result in half of the structure being reverse and the other polar. So we defined a magnetic equator, and we developed the algorithm to map it. And this can lead to some points quite deep in one hemisphere that will be considered, in this case, northern, because they are north of this magnetic equator. But this leads to a non-ambiguous definition of every structure, whether it's reversed or normal. And once these are defined, it's fairly simple to identify them and to track them in time. Next, we run numerical dynamo simulations. These are solutions, self-consistent solution to the full set of magneto-hydrodynamic equations in a rotating convecting spherical shell. The Navier-Stokes equation is just the Newton's second law. The acceleration of the flow is due to all the forces acting on it. So that's the inertial force, the viscous force, the Coriolis force that is very important for rapidly rotating inviscid systems, pressure gradient force, the buoyancy force that is responsible for convection. Here it's written in terms of temperature, but this can be generally thought of as co-density, as the combination of temperature and light elements that are the two sources of convection in the core, and a magnetic Lorentz force here. The induction equation is just the result of the set of Maxwell's equations of electromagnetism, and this says that the change of the magnetic field with time is due to advection that is generating the dynamo and diffusion that is destroying the dynamo due to the finite electrical conductivity of the fluid. So the system is fully coupled in a sense that the flow is advecting the field and changing it, and in response, the field through the magnetic force is changing or affecting the velocity field. Then there is a heat equation or a co-density equation for the change in time of temperature due to advection and diffusion. And there is the incompressibility equation for conservation of mass and non-magnetic monopoles, which is part of the Maxwell set. So this is the non-dimensional form of the equations. Here there are four non-dimensional numbers. One is the Rayleigh number, here defined in terms of the heat flux on the core-mantle boundary, which is the ratio of the forces, the convective force, and the retarding forces, the thermal and viscous diffusivities. The Ekman number is the ratio of viscous force to Coriolis force, so it represents the importance of rotation. And the two Prandtl numbers are the ratios of the three diffusivities in the system, which are the viscosity, thermal diffusivity, and magnetic diffusivity, which is just the inverse of the electrical conductivity. And there were many studies that investigated the type of solutions we get from numerical dynamos. And what these studies found is that there are, in general, two types of families of solutions. One is that a solution with a dipole-dominated magnetic field, so quite similar to what we observe today, but no reversals. And the other family is solutions with reversals, like in the Palermo magnetic record, but the field is much more multipolar and very different from the present-day field. So this is a plot from a study by Peter from his PhD. And what they show here is the solution as a function of convection, which is increasing with the Rayleigh number, and rotation, rapid rotation here is to the left when the Ekman number is smaller. The size of the circles is the dipolarity of the system, and the colors is the reversal frequency. So empty is no reversals at all, and as the colors get paler, the reversal frequency is increasing. And this dashed line separates these two families of solutions. So to the left are solutions that are dipole-dominated, non-reversing, and to the right is multipolar and reversing. So we see that by increasing the convection, we can cross this line and move from the non-reversing to the reversing regimes. And by increasing rotation, we can go from the other direction, from the reversing to the non-reversing. So this tells us what are the effects of rotation and convection on the dynamo regime. And it could be that the Earth is, in fact, quite close to this transition, and small changes in the convection in the core or in the rotation rate can turn the dynamo from one place to another. Another thing to consider when studying core dynamics is the boundary conditions, and in particular, the outer boundary condition that is well known to us from seismology. The D prime prime layer at the bottom of the mantle is the most heterogeneous, laterally heterogeneous place on Earth. And seismic anomalies there, seismic shear wave velocity anomalies there, have been used to construct a CMB heat flux model. So in places where the seismic shear velocity is positive, these are places that are cold. And because from the mantle point of view, the CMB is an isotherm, these are places where the heat flux is larger. And the way, the way it affects the dynamo is the following. If you consider a cold mantle here, then this is where the CMB heat flux is large. It will extract more heat from the core. It will leave a cold core fluid, and this core-cold fluid will want to sink, and will create downwelling. And downwelling tends to concentrate magnetic field lines, and by that, affecting the morphology of the dynamo. There are various reasons why the CMB heat flux and the D prime prime will be heterogeneous. There's a sketch here of all kinds of scenarios. One is the presence of large low shear wave velocity provinces as observed below Africa and the Pacific, ultra low velocity zones at the edge of these layers, post-perovskite transitions, chemical heterogeneities, and giant impacts can also produce CMB heat flux heterogeneity. This was invoked in the context of the ancient dynamo of Mars. So this kind of heterogeneous boundary condition can explain a lot of deviations from axisymmetry that are otherwise difficult to explain. For the final part of my presentation, I'll talk about tracing ionospheric field lines to the Earth's surface. And the way we did it, we took a field model, for a core field model during a reversal, and superimposed it with a uniform external field. And from the magnetopause, we looked for the open field lines to the Earth's surface by solving an ordinary differential equation. And the polar caps, the region of auroral zones, are regions that are separated by these open and closed field lines. So I'll start with the first study of establishing the relation between the morphology of the field on the CMB and at the intensity of the Earth's surface. And we constructed synthetic field models that we invented just to get some fundamental understanding. So this is the radial field on the CMB in these synthetic models, and that's the response of the surface intensity. All these synthetic field models have a background axial dipole that defines the polarity, the local polarity, and some local Gaussian isotropic flux patches. In this case, for example, two reverse flux patches in very distant longitudes, one at each hemisphere, and the response is two surface intensity minima at the exact same longitudes, but at lower latitudes, because the latitude is a competition between the local effect of these patches and the effect of the background axial dipole that wishes to localize the minimum intensity on the geographic equator. Now, when we look at the effect with one reverse flux patch and one normal flux patch, the surface intensity is in the longitude of the reverse flux patch. And when we put these two structures in the same longitude, it is still in the same longitude, but at somewhat lower latitude. It's a little bit difficult to see. But the effect is that the proximity of the normal flux patch is repelling the surface intensity away. And finally, when we have two reverse flux patches and one normal flux patch, the anomaly will be only in the longitude of the reverse flux patch. So the conclusion from this test is that the longitude of the intensity minima is controlled by reverse flux patches, and it tends to be far from normal flux patches. Now we go to more Earth-like configuration of structures. So we put four high-latitude flux patches like in the Earth, and reverse flux patches in the South Atlantic, and one normal flux patch at the equator near Africa. All these are features that exist. And we already reproduced the correct longitude of the South Atlantic anomaly, but the latitude is too small. So we decrease the axial dipole, and it helps a bit. The latitude increases. We add another flux patch, a normal flux patch that exists in West Africa, and it increases further. And finally, we move this structure from below Brazil to below Patagonia, and bingo, we reach a good latitude. So this is a demonstration that the combination of some robust local features in the core mantle boundary can explain most of the location of the South Atlantic anomaly. Now we take this last scenario that was the closest configuration to Earth-like conditions, and we apply some secular variation scenarios. One is advection of all the low and mid-latitude structures in a fixed angular velocity, and we get the motion, this advection to the west. We get a westward motion of the South Atlantic anomaly, but in a somewhat slower pace, which is not trivial. Second, we apply upwelling or downwelling on this reverse flux patch. And we get that in the case of upwelling, where the flux patch is expanding and weakening, we get motion to lower latitudes and to the east. And finally, when we apply diffusion, so the expulsion of flux from below, we get little effect on the coordinates of the anomaly. When we look at the effects of the same mechanism on the intensity, on the minimum intensity value itself, and here the main thing is to compare the scales, we see that the most effective mechanism to reduce the intensity is diffusion. So we need advection to explain the motion and diffusion to explain the changes in intensity. Now we apply to geomagnetic field models. These are five snapshots of geomagnetic field models. Here are the radial field on the core mantle boundary with diamonds representing centers of reverse and normal flux patches. These are the surface intensity outcome. And in between, it's an intensity kernel. It represents the sensitivity at the point of the minimum intensity to the value of the field on the CMB. So this intensity kernel is a nonlinear kernel in a sense that it doesn't depend only on the geometry around the point of interest, but also on the field itself. So it cannot be analytically analyzed. It has to be numerically analyzed. And the conclusion from looking at these maps is that the centers of the South Atlantic anomaly do not correspond to the center of the intensity kernel and do not correspond to the centers of the reverse flux region. So the solution is not trivial, and this is not a surprise because we already saw that it's a combination of the configuration of reverse and normal patches that can allow us to understand the location of the anomaly at the surface. So we looked one by one at the effect of reverse and normal flux patches. These are reverse flux patches. So the colored symbols is the South Atlantic anomaly, and the empty symbols are the reverse flux patches. And we see that both go westward. This is longitude versus time. So this is easy to understand. But when we look at latitude, we see that the anomaly goes to the pole, and the South American reverse flux patch goes to the pole, but the African patch goes to the equator. So this tells us that this is not the entire story. When we look at the normal flux patches, this is a bit of a difficult quantity to understand. It's the integrated normal flux in the southern hemisphere along longitude lines. And we see that these are five different snapshots, and the African normal flux patches are increasing in strength as we go from black to pink to green to blue to red with time. So this is repelling the South Atlantic anomaly from Africa. In contrast, the high latitude flux patch below Patagonia, below the South Pacific, is weakening this time, which allows the anomaly to go poleward in this region. So I will not repeat all the conclusions of this study, but the main take-home message is that the position and the motion of the South Atlantic anomaly can be explained by following the evolution of several robust flux patches, reverse and normal, on the core mantle boundary. Next, we address the question of the persistence of the South Atlantic anomaly. One interesting aspect that I think was not discussed in the literature much is, in fact, that in most snapshots, we get more than one minima. Even today, this is the minima below South America, and this is an emerging, less deep minima below Africa. So we will, in this study, we take into consideration all the minima and attribute to them correct weight based on their intensity. So when we do this for many field models, so here I show eight field models. This is a field model based on satellite data for the past 20 years. This is an historical field model for the past 150 years. And these are six different archaeomagnetic field models for the last 3,000 years. So obviously, here there's more data, but less resolution and less confidence. And here there's more resolution and confidence, but much less data. And the statistical analysis is less significant. So we look at the two types of models, or even the three, together. And what we see, we construct histograms of the surface intensity minima here longitudes. what we see is that, and the vertical red lines are the peaks of these histograms, we see that there are peaks at South America, East Africa, and East Asia in many of these models. When we look at latitude, we got a very interesting result. At present day, the anomaly is deep at mid-latitudes, at around 26 degrees south. When we look at the archaeomagnetic field models, the anomaly is very close, it's centered very close to the equator. So one possibility is that these archaeomagnetic field models don't have enough resolution, and that's why we don't see the anomaly at high latitudes, but I will soon show you that this is not the case. So now we want to compare it with numerical dynamos, and we apply heterogeneous boundary condition and the core mantle boundary based on the seismic tomography models. The models we use are dipole dominant non-reversing because we are modeling a phenomena during a cron, during a period that there are no reversals. We look at 28 models, and the computationally costly part of this study is that the runs have to be long in order to have meaningful statistics. And there are several novelties in this study. Systematic studies of numerical dynamos with heterogeneous boundary conditions were mostly done with single harmonics for fundamental understanding and not sufficiently with multi-harmonic structures like that. They usually, when they try to look at persistent feature, they usually study the time average and not long time series of snapshots that we do here. And finally, they almost always look at the radial field on the CMB rather than persistent surface intensity minima with the context of the South Atlantic anomaly. So these are the same histograms for a set of numerical dynamo simulations. The first one is a control run with homogeneous boundary conditions. And this is because there will always be small deviations from a uniform value due to the finite simulation time. So we use that to define the kind of a standard deviation in order to tell us what is a real peak in the heterogeneous runs and what is not. The red vertical lines are the different peaks that we found for the histograms of the geomagnetic field models. And what we get in the heterogeneous field models is typically two peaks below South America and East Asia. And this is not surprising because there are a boundary condition is dominated by a spherical harmonic degree in order 2. But this has never been shown before. And when we look at the latitude histograms, we see the same thing that we saw with the archaeomagnetic field models. We see that the centers are very close to the equator. So this is refuting the possibility that the archaeomagnetic field models are just low resolution models, because the numerical dynamos actually, they are much higher resolution than any observation, even based on satellite data. So the resolution is probably not the issue here. So it's a big, we see some tendency to the south. These distributions are skewed and they are not symmetric, but still the absolute value is very close to the equator. So one of the main questions to address here is, why is it that archaeomagnetic field models and the dynamo simulations give such strong preference to equatorial location of the anomaly, while today we have it at 26 south? So to do that, we studied the relation between the surface intensity minimum latitude and the role of reverse and normal flux patches. On the surface side, in every snapshot, we calculated the weighted intensity minimum based on its intensity itself. So a large, smaller intensity will be given more weight. And we calculated a weighted average of that to get for every snapshot the weighted latitude of the surface minima. On the CMB side, we calculated the hemisphericity of the reverse flux patch, meaning how much reverse flux there is in the southern hemisphere normalized by total, and the hemisphericity of the normal flux patch, and we accounted for the amount of reverse and normal flux. And we looked at power laws, of or a linear relation between the weighted latitude of the anomalies and the combined two hemisphericities. So every black point here is a snapshot of one dynamo simulation. Every one of these three is three different dynamo simulations. So there's a cloud of points, but there is a general a clear trend that is decreasing, and this makes sense because it means that as we have more reverse flux in the southern hemisphere and or more normal flux in the northern hemisphere, as expected, the anomaly should be in the southern hemisphere. In the dynamo models, this normal flux hemisphericity is more important. And the colored symbols are the geomagnetic field data during the historical era, with these last two points representing the most recent satellite data. So we see that in most time, the dynamo models are in decent agreement with the observations. And it's only the very recent last two decades that deviate from these laws. And this leads us to think that at present day, or to propose that at present day, the field is behaving in an anomalous way. Now, looking at the dynamics of the South Atlantic anomaly, we look here at the upwelling, downwelling at the top of the core, and the radial vorticity that represents the non-divergent motion at the top of the core, just below the Ekman boundary layer. At the top is a snapshot from a dynamo simulation with heterogeneous boundary condition. So we see a lot of small scale, very time dependent and chaotic, but also a lot of north strife elongated strips that are classical signature of rapid rotation effects. And we also see a very good correlation between these two properties in the southern hemisphere and anti-correlation in the northern hemisphere, which as part of my thesis, we termed it a helical flow. And when we look at the time averages of these simulations, we see also that the helical flow expression holds very nicely. We also see persistent upwelling in the South Atlantic region, which is in very good agreement with the observations of today. And finally, when the simulation is with homogeneous boundary condition, there's no deviation from axis symmetry, and there's no deviation from north-south asymmetry, as expected. When we look at the zonal velocity profiles for the same three cases, we see that in the heterogeneous case, both in the snapshot and in the time average, we see at the surface a lot of westward flow. That's the blue region here and here. And in the northern hemisphere, a lot of eastward flow. So there's a clear north-south dichotomy that arises due to the boundary condition because we don't see it at the homogeneous case. And this emerges very quickly at the snapshot. No need to wait for a time average when looking at the zonal velocity profiles. So in order to explain the tendency of the South Atlantic anomaly to be in the southern hemisphere and the preferred activity, magnetic and convective activity in the northern hemisphere, we look at the zonal profile of the boundary condition of the CMB heat flux. And we see that the CMB heat flux is much larger in the northern hemisphere than in the southern hemisphere. So the large CMB heat flux in the northern hemisphere is producing a stronger downwelling in the tangent cylinder area, stronger normal flux in the northern hemisphere, and as a result, surface intensity minima in the southern hemisphere. Now, looking at the parameter dependence of the solutions, these are general power law solutions to the all the numerical dynamo cases. Each point represents one dynamo model. On the y-axis is a parameter that represents the persistence of preferred longitude, which is the peak of the longitude, the height of the peak of the longitude histograms. And on the x-axis are the four control parameters of the simulation, the Ekman Rayleigh magnetic Prandtl numbers, and also the amplitude of the heat flux heterogeneity that is imposed with the boundary condition. And the result is expected that slower rotation and stronger convection driven both by the boundary heterogeneity and by the main convection produce stronger preferred locations of surface intensity minima. We apply also a power law for the latitude of the anomaly, the mean latitude of the anomaly, and we get the same type of relation. So we can plot the two outputs, one against the other, the latitude of the anomaly and the persistence of the preferred locations. The black points here are the numerical dynamo simulations, and the red are the observations. This is the present day, very far from the values of the dynamo simulations. And there is some agreement between the trends of the points. And this is suggestive that the southern location of the South Atlantic anomaly is controlled indeed by the mantle in a statistical sense. So the main results are that we find a persistent upwelling below the South Atlantic anomaly, below the South Atlantic in most dynamo models. And this is clearly generated by the heat flux heterogeneity. And when the mantle control is stronger, when the control parameters produce strong mantle control on the geodynamo, we get more persistent surface intensity minima and more to the south. Finally, I mentioned that the ionospheric field is sensitive to the geomagnetic field. And because the South Atlantic anomaly is related both to reverse flux patches, and the reverse flux patches are related to dipole intensity, it is interesting to see what's happening during a reversal. And in particular, what is the impact of the reversing field on the ionospheric field, and where will auroral zones will be found during the reversals. So we looked at four conceptual scenarios of reversals. We start from the present day field. That's the intensity and the inclination at the surface of the Earth. One scenario is dipole collapse. It means that all three dipole components decrease, but the rest of the field remains unchanged. The other is just axial dipole collapse. So we maintain also the equatorial dipole. Dipole rotation is a scenario where the axial dipole energy moves to the equatorial dipole. And energy cascade is a scenario when the dipole energy moves to higher degrees while maintaining the relative powers. These are the solutions for the intensity and inclination of the field with 50% dipole collapse and 90% dipole collapse. So the interesting thing to see already here is that at high altitudes, even when the dipole is decreasing, it is still quite dominant because far from the source of the field, the lowest degrees are the most dominant. But it's beginning to get lost at 90% dipole collapse. And these are the other scenarios for the axial dipole collapse and the dipole rotation, where we get a clear dominance of the equatorial dipole in both cases. And in the case of the energy cascade, we get multipolar dominance of the morphology of the field at high altitudes. When tracing the ionospheric field lines to the Earth's surface, at present days, we have two magnetic poles that are very close to the axis of the intersection of the dipole with the surface of the Earth. We get two poles also at the meridian of 90 degrees east for the axial dipole collapse, but these two poles are equatorial. But for the other meridian and for the energy cascade scenario, we get a much more multipolar, small-scale structure. And when we look at the boundary between the open and closed feed lines to define the polar caps regions where aurorals are expected, we see very small difference between the present day and the 50% dipole collapse. This is due to the fact that even when reduced by a factor 2, the dipole is still important in these high altitudes. But when we get to 90% collapse, interestingly, the southern polar caps moves to mid-latitudes. The north stays in place. And this is already an interesting effect of the South Atlantic anomaly, which appears in the pre-reversal field model. In the other scenarios, when the axial dipole goes to zero, we get equatorial dipole dominance, but the two centers of structures are again in the southern hemisphere. In a dipole rotation scenario, when the equatorial dipole is very strong, obviously the structures are on the equator. And in the energy cascade scenario, you get four structures that represent the emergence of the non-axial quadrupole dominance in this scenario. So to summarize, we see a very nice hemispheric dichotomy between north and south due to the South Atlantic anomaly in the pre-reversal field. So this is interesting to effect of the South Atlantic anomaly on the ionospheric field. So I'd like to very quickly show a couple of ideas for the future. One of them I mentioned in the beginning that there are some analyses of local Archaeo intensity time series that argued for the antiquity of the South Atlantic anomaly below Africa and South America. But there's no good establishment of the relation between local time series and global features of the field. So this is one first study of my colleagues from Sao Paulo that try to establish this kind of relation with synthetic field models. And they look at, they choose an observatory at the surface of the Earth. They invent the synthetic field models and they try to show that it's possible to have some sharp decrease of field components without necessarily being in a point that represents the minimum of the surface field intensity. So there's plenty of work to do in this direction, I believe. A second thing that I've been working on a lot in recent years is to try to get a better model for the CMB heat flux, because what we do now is we take seismic anomalies and we assume that they are the same as thermal anomalies. But there are several sources of heterogeneity, the lower mantle, like chemical heterogeneity or post-perovskite, that might bias this idealistic picture. And in particular, the core mantle boundary heat flux is sensitive to the temperature right above the CMB, while the seismic models are applying some vertical integration. So this is, in this study that we are currently working on, we look at the output from mantle convection simulations that have thermal, compositional, and mineral heterogeneities. And we try to compare the temperature anomalies at the very last grid point above the core mantle boundary, so at the bottom of the mantle simulation, with the seismic anomaly integrated over 200 kilometers. And we see some nonlinear effect. It's difficult to see the points here, but there are points that stretch here. There is a branch. And this nonlinear effect we would like to apply on observed seismic tomography models in order to get a more realistic boundary condition for geodynamo simulations with the goal of recovering the South Atlantic anomaly latitude in mind. Finally, I think that it's worthwhile taking a step back and getting a better fundamental understanding by running simulations with dynamo simulations with single harmonic boundary conditions to see the effect of particular boundary conditions on the location of the South Atlantic anomaly. This has been done very vigorously for other problems, for example, for reversal frequency. In this study, they took a lot of different single harmonic boundary conditions and show how much the models reverse for per unit of time. So I'd like to apply this kind of philosophy for studying the South Atlantic anomaly. And finally, for the polar caps, we would like to look at the way it has evolved during the historical area where we have good data. And thanks a lot. Yes, very much. It is very strongly affecting the results, and if it's wrong, then the models are wrong. So that's the goal of this study. In this study, there is, in this Mandel convection simulations, there are compositional heterogeneities. So this will affect the relation between seismic and thermal anomalies. The weak part of this study is that in order to calculate the seismic anomalies, so the thermal anomalies and the compositional and the post-perovskite anomalies are all consistently embedded in the simulation. But the seismic anomalies are calculated using an equation of state. And the equation of state have three coefficients which represent the sensitivities of the seismic anomalies to the three types of anomalies. And these coefficients are very crucial in order to get the right seismic anomalies from the Mantel convection simulation. But assuming that we have, there are some independent studies with estimates of these. So this kind of studies can allow for compositional anomalies to produce the correct nonlinear relation between seismic and thermal anomalies and perhaps reduce or flatten the effect of LLSVPs like you suggest.
This is a question for Greenewalt Lecture Hall.
Yes, we can apply the same study for other planets, for sure. If we think about candidates, then I would say that Mercury and Saturn are bad candidates because they are purely axisymmetric. So there's no difference in one longitude and another in these planets. So they are not relevant. Mars doesn't have a dynamo today, so it's also not relevant. And perhaps the best candidate is Jupiter. And now there are new data from Juno for Jupiter. So looking at surface intensity minima in Jupiter could be very interesting. Of course, we don't have a long record in Jupiter. So we only know the field in a snapshot in practice. And we have no knowledge of any lateral heterogeneity at the interior of Jupiter. So everything is a bit more difficult in the planets than in Earth, but Peter is working on extrasolar planets. It's even worse than Jupiter. Yes, in terms of data. Oh, it's better. Yes, it's better. Is anomalous, yes.
Anomalous and only very recent. And you also said this latitude is by mental processes. My direct question is, what exactly has changed in the mental in recent time to
No, nothing has changed in the mantle. We consider the last 5 million years as steady from a mantle point of view. So nothing has changed in the mantle, but what we have to keep in mind is that in these distributions, there is a mean, but there's a tail also. So when we say anomalous, we want to say that at present day, the Earth is at the tail of the distribution.
Right.
So it doesn't mean... Yes, it doesn't mean that it's impossible, yeah. It's just improbable, but the tail includes the solution. So by anomalous is being in the tail of the distribution. Yeah.
What would happen if the core, top of the core is thermally stratified? Dynamos being driven by how weaken this coupling?
Well, the study of Olson et al. 2017 have shown that even if you have stratification at the top of the core, if you impose on top of the stratification CMB heat flux heterogeneity, then in the places where the heat flux anomaly is positive, it can overcome and get to a super adiabatic condition and allow for penetration of the stratified layer. So it all depends on how deep and how strong is the stratification. In the study of Christensen 2018, he imposed a very strong stratification and there were no penetration. In Olson et al.
But no heterogeneity.
No, no, heterogeneity. Yes, in both cases, they looked at the combined effect of heterogeneity and stratification. If the stratification is very strong and very deep, then indeed the boundary condition will not be able to do much.
But does this say that the stratification
is not so deep? Not so strong, it turns out, because both these studies looked at about the same stratification of several hundred kilometers, but they looked at different adiabatic gradients. So when the stratification is very strong, like in Christensen's study, the mantle cannot do much. And when it's weak, like in Olson's study, you can have penetration of the stratification by the heat flux heterogeneity and produce these flux patches, which were exactly the criteria that he used in order to determine the depth of the stratified layer. So there's a lot of interest in this issue, as you know. Thank you. That's what Peter did. He looked at the morphological agreement between his models. He